heaven?
No. It's Iowa.
God tells us we have to podcast today.
How many francs will that be? How much will we charge?
To touch my wee-wee.
Oh.
Wee-wee touching on podcast.
They won't be able to see the wee-wee touching. Why will they like it? Sounds like I asked a good question.
Well, let's get into it. We're talking poor things on the Pot of Dreams.
This is Bella. Bella, this is Mr. McCandles.
Hello, Bella.
No! Oh. She's an experiment.
Good evening.
Her brain and her body are not quite synchronized. But she is progressing at an accelerated pace.
Tell me, where did she come from?
I shall. For it is a happy tale.
I am Bella Baxter. And there is a world to enjoy, circumnavigate. It is the goal of all to progress, grow.
A woman plotting her course to freedom. How delightful.
Thank you for listening to our podcast called The Pod of Dreams. We're talking poor things. If you listen, we will pod. Eric, Ben, and Kevin here. This is our Oscar special. And I picked this film, Poor Things. I hadn't seen it before. Watched it the weekend of the Oscars. So this is like fresh in our mind. And boy, is this movie strange.
It won Oscar gold, though. Four of them, I think.
Four Oscars. Yeah. I was nervous. We were talking earlier. I'm a big Nolan person. If you haven't listened to any of our episodes before, maybe you've picked up on that. If you have, I really wanted Oppenheimer to win, and Poor Things started winning awards. I got really nervous that something weird might happen. Didn't end up winning Best Picture, but Emma Stone took home the Oscar for Best Actress, which I think that's a good place to start because she plays in this movie a pregnant woman who tries to kill herself.
She seems successful at it.
Right. She does. She does die, right? Her brain dies.
Yeah. She just happens to float the right direction for Willem Dafoe to find
monster,
her body.
Monster Frankenstein Willem Dafoe finds her body, takes the baby out of her body, takes the brain out of the baby, puts the baby's brain in Emma Stone, and then reanimates her and calls her Bella. And that is the character she plays in this movie. Weird setup. Just starting there, like, wow. What a crazy idea for a movie.
So let's pause there. So Kevin was the first to watch this, and he sent some text messages early on. Kevin, you were roughly 5-10 minutes in, and if you weren't, you said roughly, approximately, if you weren't required to watch this for the podcast, you would have turned it off.
I would have.
You didn't turn it off. I think I know why you didn't like it and wanted to turn it off.
Well, the first 10 minutes are very disturbing, right? There's a lot of disturbing shit you see right away in this movie. So I don't blame you.
No, I get it. It's probably the straight up weirdest, most uncomfortable part of the movie, really. Well, it gets uncomfortable in different ways. But this is like bizarro.
Once the whoring starts.
Yeah, did you regret watching it and pushing through past the early Bella is a baby / toddler?
Well, I was scared that that's all we would get for an 2-hour runtime.
Okay.
Is her acting that way and
an adult acting like a baby.
Yes.
Like a psychotic baby. I really didn't care for that part. I'm with you.
Yeah. Well, I'm not an Emma Stone fan.
Right.
So that weighed heavily into it as well. I don't get her attractiveness. Like, I think Max McCandless is like
McCandles. With her.
McCandles?
Yeah, I think it was McCandles.
Like, okay. McCandles. He was spitting with her like right away. And that just like, I needed to have some, a little bit of suspension of disbelief for myself to buy into that.
Well, so was Ruffalo. Both of the guys were just like, oh my God, she's just beautiful. I mean, and you don't think Emma Stone's attractive? I think we need to start there. Like, what's going on here?
Yeah, I don't. Especially the way she was made up in this movie. She looked particularly strange.
Okay. It wasn't the baby part. You were okay with that. I would say
this isn't the hottest Emma Stone has ever looked.
The baby part was very off-putting as well.
Well, and you couldn't separate that. It made it very bizarre to like.
And the fact that they were so attracted to her in that baby form. I get it. It's satire. You know, men are monsters and they love innocence and purity and all that. And that's what they were going for, is satirizing that. But it was off-putting.
I mean, I think it's supposed to be in the movie's defense. I mean, I don't think you're supposed to find it kinky or fun. It's supposed to be unsettling.
Yeah.
But you have to push through it. And it gets better in the sense that, yes, she keeps developing and she goes from like toddler to child to teenager to like, you know, full-fledged adult mentally throughout the movie.
Yeah, and I found that transition to be very impressive. I can see why she won an Oscar for it.
Well, and apparently they filmed it like out of sequence too, so she'd have to like jump back and forth and remember like what part of the baby transformation she was in, which I think makes it even more difficult, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Like how she'd walk too, like, you know, she'd walk kind of weird with her arms out, you know, like a toddler would walk. And
yeah, not very steady.
Yeah.
And weird. And yeah, she had the mannerisms down really well, I thought. I mean, you could kind of just tell by her gait and the way she moved.
So the movie like grew on at. You? Is that what happened, Kevin?
Yeah, it literally did. She grew on me.
As Bella grew, you grew.
Yeah. By the end of the movie, I really enjoyed it and thought that there was a well-done arc by her and her character. And it was just, I was also blown away by how gorgeous the movie looked.
Oh, it was really fun to look at. I mean, I get all this, like the set design.
Like a Wes Anderson kind of world he created.
It's like a sort of steampunk Victorian look.
Yeah.
Yeah, almost like Wes Anderson meets Frankenstein.
Yeah.
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 With a little, with a little creepy, weird edge to it. She does have the arc, but can we? I mean, I probably like the weirdest most of anybody, and not necessarily
a pervert.
You can like something and not like it sexually, Kevin. I don't know if this is
how the whoring. The whoring was your favorite part. The like 45 minutes of her whoring.
Well, no, my favorite part is probably Mark Ruffalo slowly disintegrating. Well,
Mark Ruffalo was unbelievable.
That was probably the single greatest highlight of the movie. But the general weird vibe, not in a sexual context, like Willem Dafoe, at one point the makeup work and his character design, he's sitting there at a table, and at one point he just goes, and coughs out this bubble.
Yeah, he does that a number of times.
The first time we don't have any context for it, we eventually learn what's going on.
Yeah, the McCandles guy he's us. We've seen it for the first time. He's like, what the hell is happening here?
And it is insane. I saw that bubble come out, and I'm like, all right, we're going somewhere weird with this movie. They've got me. This is an interesting setup. My brain is very curious where we're going to go. And that from there, and just the way his face looks, just all cut up. I thought he was Frankenstein's monster at first. I thought, oh, is this like just a version where Frankenstein's monster grows up and becomes like a Frankenstein? Surgeon. Like, yeah, I thought that was maybe where it was going to go early on. And then he's at some weird institute. Like the architecture is so weird in this movie, and there's like weird technological stuff like sky carts that are just in the background that we see. I mean, I just love the way it looks. But the general vibe had me on board probably more so than either one of you do, who were off put by the initial vibes. But even little touches, Emma Stone being like, when she hits toddler, she's walking around. Willem Dafoe is always like slicing up dead bodies all throughout the movie, just constantly doing what? I mean, we don't know, just fucking with dead bodies all the time. And there's just like a cadaver sitting around, and Emma Stone walks by and just flicks this penis just out of like toddler curiosity. It was like, oh, this is okay.
Yeah, see, but that part of then I started having some questions, because I think it's that same scene where she grabs a knife and just starts stabbing the body, right? Or maybe it's a later scene, but it's around that same time.
Yeah,
it's the same scene, yeah.
Is she psychotic? Because, like, I think the movie's trying to say is, like, you know, it, like you were saying, innocence. She's an adult that has, like, a baby's mind hasn't been destroyed by, you know, life itself yet. But, like, why would she be violent and psychotic?
Yeah, she punches Max the first time right. She sees him and makes him bleed, and like, she kills a frog
right.
for no reason.
Squashes it. She sees it. And she's like, "Oh, kill it." She's like,
toddlers are violent, but they're not usually like, full size adults.
Not all like that.
You never
that,
gotten
though.
Hit by a toddler. You never been smacked by a toddler. I have.
My
daughter had a
but...
biting phase when she was probably around two. First she got bit by other kids, then she bit, and then she got
I think kids killing animals is that's like a warning sign for serial killers. I don't know.
I don't know. A two-year-old? I don't know. She doesn't know enough to really know or have any conceptions about death and weirdness in a way that is, like, upsetting. She's just like, it's just a dead body. And her dad encourages it, her adopted dad.
What I'm
dad.
Saying is, like, I was like, is this a horror movie? Like, what's going on here? Is she just going to start murdering people? Because I had really no sense of what the plot of the movie was. So, I don't know. I think you get your point across without that kind of shit in there. For me, like, the off-putting first half hour, I think it really... this movie started, I think, with you, Kevin, is like, all right, I don't like this. I don't like any of this. It's going to have to really get better, and really it's going to have a real point it's trying to get across for me to get on board.
Yeah.
And it sounded like it for you. It did. It really did get its.
It definitely did.
Oh yeah. I don't think it was even very subtle about its point. Basically every step of the way men try to control women's bodies. And they're just only really like bad options for women. But I like the weirdness. I don't know. This isn't like anything I've seen before. You thought she was psychotic. I just thought she was a normal toddler with a weird dad who didn't care about her doing stuff like that, who liked the curiosity, and she didn't care. She wasn't like, oh, gross dead bodies. It's just like, oh, it's just I've always seen dead bodies since I was a baby. I get how it would be off-putting for most people because it is weird and awkward. But either of you two laugh at any point in the movie? Because this is ostensibly a black comedy amongst other things. Did you laugh at all? Either one of you?
Oh, yeah, I did. There was a few Willem Dafoe lines where he's talking about his dad and what his dad did to him that I thought was just hilarious. Like, he would just throw it in there. I can't remember some of the specific lines.
Oh, he's describing his dad torturing him, basically.
Yeah.
And he'd do it nonchalantly without any passion or anger or anything. It's like, my dad cut out my appendix or whatever. Like, yeah, just nonchalant.
And then Ruffalo. Everything Ruffalo said.
Yeah. He was very amusing. I don't know if it was ha-ha funny, but it was definitely entertaining.
You've been thrice fucked by the very best. He was just such a cocky piece of shit, you know?
Oh, everything. See, like, when Willem Dafoe was looking at the marriage contract, he's like, there are a lot of spelling errors.
Spelling errors, yeah.
They'll have no effect on the binding of the contract, I assure you.
Yeah, he's supposed to be a lawyer, and they just
he's an idiot lawyer. He's a dummy. I mean, clearly he's not a smart guy. But William Dafoe had a few, and then at the wedding towards the end, when Mark Ruffalo is like, look at him, he's terrible, what's wrong with him? It's like, he's dying of cancer. And he just nonchalantly describes how he's taking all these drugs. I've got heroin for this, heroin this, and I've got cocaine.
Oh, yeah.
I'm a fan of cocaine.
That part was funny. Yeah, there were definitely some laugh out loud moments in the movie.
Okay. I didn't know if the comedy worked, but that's a good sign that you didn't hate it if you got some laughs out of it. But yeah, the movie takes off and it really kicks into gear when Mark Ruffalo shows up and Emma Stone leaves, Bella leaves the castle or wherever it is. And that's where it picks up. Anybody that hasn't seen the movie and needs a synopsis, I mean, what's, you said McCandle, Max McCandle is a student at Willem Dafoe's college, whatever it is. I don't know what it is.
Medical school, maybe? Yeah.
It looked weird and abstract, but needs him, basically becomes his assistant, and he just documents Bella's progress, and we see her developing, and she gets old enough that she starts like discovering her sexuality.
But McCandless, he falls in love with her, and they get betrothed or whatever.
But again, like, what are they saying with McCandless? That like some guys aren't awful, but he also still fell in love. Right, he still fell in love with this, you know, baby. Yeah, like
he was gonna get her to sign a marriage contract before she knew what she was doing.
He knew everything about her, and yet he still fell in love.
But I think he did genuinely love her, right? And was going to sort of take care of her in a weird way.
It's nebulous. Eventually, at some point, when she gets enough agency, but I don't think
she had feelings for him too. Like in the end, when she kisses him, she's like, not as much tongue, but otherwise it was pleasant. But
it's practical for her at that point. It's pragmatic. I'm enjoying our pragmatic relationship because she said, all right, your kissing was pleasant, but you used too much tongue. We'll work on it. And he said, have you been tested for any STDs?
Yeah,
and
she's diseases, like,
No, I have not, but I will. I'm enjoying this pragmatic approach. He's the pragmatic choice. And from a logic standpoint, I think she's like, oh, he makes sense. He knows what's going on. He's smart. I should.
But did they end up together is the question.
I didn't know. I couldn't tell that if it was a throuple situation or what was going on at the end.
Yeah, okay.
It was, I think, deliberately ambiguous for my sake. We don't know.
Maybe the goat had something to do with it, too.
Oh, yeah. I think, maybe she changed her mind and also decided marriage wasn't a good path forth, because that's an option at first, but we see, like, even marriage is him trying to exploit her. She was going to have to stay in the house and all the stuff. And the marriage is also Willem Dafoe trying to control her. I mean, from day one, Willem Dafoe is trying to trap her and control her. For his own benefit, for him, it's not sexual, but he's still... wants to dictate who she marries and what she does.
Well, he's the only reason it wasn't sexual, right? Is he? There was that bit about how his like genitals were removed or something.
He's like it would take more electricity than powers North London to for me to achieve arousal. And at this point, my paternal instincts outweigh my sexual interest or something like that.
Right. Yep. Yeah. That was almost word for word. Nice job, Ben. Well,
thank you.
Crushing the podcast.
Well, that's what it's, it was.
Should we just refer to you as God from now on?
Please no. Please no, thank you. No. I reject that. But anyway, my point is, I don't think Max is. You can view Max. I mean, he's maybe less terrible if you want to do a ranking of how shitty the men are in this movie. He's probably less shitty than Mark Ruffalo. But
he's the only one that doesn't get like there aren't consequences to his actions. You know, the one guy gets turned into like a goat brain. Ruffalo's life is destroyed. Willem Dafoe dies. Like, that's all true. The other men get like completely fucked over.
Of course, the men she sleeps with for money, they get off okay.
That's true.
They get off. Good one.
Thank you. Ultimately he gets to stay at the house, I guess. I don't know.
Be part Doesn't of he Bella's inherit back. All the money too? Right.
Wouldn't Bella inherit it? I don't know. See, that's, I don't know. Who knows?
Is Bella his daughter? No, you wouldn't. I don't know.
Bella was functionally his daughter, and he could will it to her if he wanted to. It's not like he couldn't say, I want Bella to have my estate, but that's not really the point of the movie. But it takes off when Mark Ruffalo leaves, and he's cocky, he's arrogant, and then watching everything about his worldview just disintegrate is one of the highlights of the movie. Because he's such a douche, really.
Yeah, I can see why he was nominated for Best Supporting Actor.
Yeah, it wasn't lead.
Nailed the accent, too. He totally nailed the accent, I thought. I mean, it was kind of a funny version of it, but...
Yeah.
Well, he kept it consistent. It sounded kind of goofy, but yeah, it works.
It's funny that they're all Americans, right? In the movie?
Yeah, Dafoe. He's like from Dafoe's Wisconsin.
He's from Wisconsin, right, yeah. Emma Stone, Ruffalo, they're all Americans.
Yeah. Dafoe, he could have been nominated as well. He was awesome.
I thought his performance was pitch perfect, but that's where the movie really just literally when they leave is where, and she goes out and gets to actually interact with the world as a person who really doesn't have any conceptions about how society ought to work or it does work, is just trying to discover it.
Well, like the cruise ship sequence, I didn't love that so much. Who's the comedian guy?
I know who you're talking about. He's a stand-up, and I can't think of his name.
I didn't think he did a great job. I guess I didn't know he was trying to give her agency or explain to her.
Well, this is a stage where she's dealing with wealth disparity and human suffering, which she hasn't had to reconcile with really until that point.
You're talking about her boat friend that she made?
Yeah,
two boat friends.
Yeah. So he seemed like he was kind of awful in the end because he just wanted her to suffer a little bit because he thought she was too happy or something.
Sure, Gerard Carmichael.
There it is. Yeah, well, I mean, yes, she had an aggressively positive outlook at life at that point, and he wanted to shatter it. I mean, he wanted to be an edgelord. This is the kind of person you'd meet in college or whatever. His life sucks. This is bullshit. This is just
it's the like a nihilist. Yeah.
This is a Victorian era sci-fi version movie of that. He's just sitting there and saying, like, we've got money, they don't. Look at those people suffering. And I didn't get that hotel at all. That seemed really weird. The Alexandria, where that scene takes place, where she looks down and sees the dead babies and the people just wailing. But he's like, look, if we go down there, they'll rape and murder us. It'll be bad. And that's what I would do if I were in their position. So let's not go down there. And she bites his hand. I mean, I don't know. Looks pretty fucked up. But even before we get there, I mean, Mark Ruffalo is just king shit. Bird, you can just see him desperately wrestle for control and just seeing him fail every step of the way when he encounters somebody who really doesn't care about the rules of society. They're really on Mark Ruffalo, the rules are boring, normal life sucks, this is silly. And then he meets somebody who genuinely doesn't have any conception of rules and he cannot fathom it, and just him being utterly unable to reconcile it is probably I already said it before, but my favorite part of the movie.
Why is it called Poor Things? Like, why did you?
What would be your guess?
I mean, just because that's the part of the movie where they're referring to, like, you know, the privilege and not privilege. But it was such a slight part of the movie. Why not call it Bella or something more related to it? Do you
think women could be the poor things? You're assuming it, you know, money's...
Maybe. Yeah, I suppose that's why she went into the whoring, was to... You know, I did like the house mother or whatever. I thought she was good. And... You know, she was the whatever line she had about like seeing a woman take control of her own life or start her own adventure. I thought that was kind of cool. And then to have her go into like just get fucked for like half an hour is just kind of funny. But
I mean, that's some way you could look at it. I mean, she doesn't get to say no. That's the problem. But she tries to take some agency and make that process better. And that woman who's ultimately a realist, like, you got to do this. Go make money. I've got a grandkid that needs a lot of medicine. So I need you to get up there and fuck some guy and give me my 10 francs. Ultimately, just pragmatic about it. But, yeah, I mean, you can read any number of things. But, yeah, I mean, women you could talk about in terms of economics. Maybe men are the poor things because they have these impulses that they actually aren't able to control, and they're desperate, and so they treat women awfully. I mean, I'd take it however you want. I mean, just like I would ask who you think the poor things are, and you could kind of go a lot of different directions with it. Bella would be the worst. I think Bella would, I don't know, like, who's Bella? I don't know who Bella is.
Baby brain?
I don't know. I think Poor Things is kind of a classier title. I don't know. Baby Brain? I'm going to go see Baby Brain? Sounds like a hardcore band or something. Go see Baby Brain, man. Really good stuff.
But yeah, I mean, I think it was pretty funny. I think, you know, Emma Stone did a very good job. She was convincing, although there was a large part of it I didn't enjoy. Like, I just didn't like watching her act like a baby child for most of the movie. I think once she became more of an adult-esque type person is really when I started to enjoy it more, and sure. I thought Ruffalo was great. I thought it was pretty good. Just that's my overall feeling on it. I enjoyed it enough. It was probably the bottom tier for me in terms of the Oscar movies. I didn't see all of them. I didn't see American Fiction, and then I didn't see Zone of Interest, but I did see the other eight Oscar movies.
We made some headway. We watched Killers of the Flower Moon and American Fiction. Killers of the Flower Moon didn't do a lot for me.
Love that movie. That's my second favorite.
There are some problems with that one, I think. But that's a different podcast. I thought this movie worked really well. Twitter discourse is, of course, a horrible place, but there's a sizable contingent on Twitter that think Poor Things is ultimately a misogynistic movie. Is that a viable claim? Do you think this movie is ultimately misogynistic?
It was written by a man. True. Right?
That's true.
It was directed by a man.
Directed by a man.
Uh-huh.
I think to see this anything other than a feminist project would, I think, be disingenuous, but I'm a man, so maybe I don't have the right perspective on it.
A lot of men do shitty things in this movie, but I don't see the movie as endorsing their actions. They're clearly in the wrong. I mean, Mark Ruffalo couldn't be ultimately more of a doofus. I mean, really, in the end. Just a complete dillweed. He can't handle her sleeping with other people, even though he's probably cheated on lots of women. He kidnaps her basically and takes her to a cruise ship. I don't know.
What is the point of showing so much nudity and sex in this? Just because that's fun to watch? It's fun to watch nudity and sex. Like, does it actually get a point across? Is that maybe misogynistic? Few dick shots, but most of it is just Emma Stone's boobs for most of the movie. Like, is that sexist? I don't know.
Yeah, that's a fair point. It's not about the structure of the movie overall. It's about how much sex they show in a way. I guess it doesn't appear overly leery to me, but yes, I mean, it's because Bella's the protagonist, we get more of her nudity than
anybody
else.
And she's just getting railed too. It's not like sex in a sensual way. It's just she's a sex worker and
depends. And she's enjoying it with Mark Ruffalo early on. And at some
right,
point,
she's like, why are we not just doing this all day long? You know, like why are we doing anything else?
Yeah, but then she realized, oh, men have a physiological limit. Oh, interesting.
Not everybody can fuck like the Hulk, I guess, apparently. Finds that out.
Right. Well, it's funny that he says that and she didn't have any context for it because he's the only man she'd slept with at the point. And then she sleeps with the first guy she's going to sleep with in Paris. And she's like, I thought you were just bragging, but that guy was terrible. He's like a three-pump chump. It wasn't enjoyable at all, but it was easy money, relatively speaking.
Yeah, and then the reaction on his face when he finds out she slept with someone else is just great, priceless.
Oh, it is. And when he finds out that she got head from some dude at a chess park early on, and he just cannot cope. Like a woman doing what he has probably done, maybe he just cannot. That does not compute in his brain. At the same point, he can't let it go. He's obsessed. He ends up in an insane asylum, right? That's where Max finds him.
Yeah.
He's just temporarily insane before he gets out.
He told her not to fall in love with him, but then he fell in love with her.
Right.
Totally lost it.
He's the MVP of the movie, I think.
Yeah.
For me.
Oh, sure. I think it's all well cast, including Emma Stone. I mean, I think this would be a very, very tough role to pull off, and I think she pulls it off. I mean, fine, you don't like her acting like a baby. It's a weird conceit. It's off-putting. Okay, but I don't know how you would do it better if you were going to do it. If you're just saying, hey, we're going to have 20 minutes of her just being a 1-3-year-old. I think she nailed it. Willem Dafoe is perfect. I don't know, just his weird nonchalant about the fact that he's just grotesque and was tortured as a kid. It's all, it works really well. I don't know. I liked it a lot. I was worried you guys were just going to out and out hate it, and I was going to have to come to bat for the movie. But it sounds like it's really just a half hour of unpleasant or so. And then,
well, the one of my main criticisms of the movie is that it's too long. They spend so much time at the brothel.
Mm-hmm.
That could have been cut in half.
Yeah, I remember at one point I looked up, I was like, there's still like an hour and a half left in this movie.
I did the same thing.
Do you think that was deliberately to give a sense of just, she gets burnt out, and I guess as the audience, maybe we do too, and that's to convey some of Bella's burnout? Like,
I just think they thought that it was funnier than it really was. Because a lot of it was for shock value and for...
And men's weird kinks.
Yeah.
That's a Yorgos Lanthimos thing. There's always those parts of his movies where he thinks that it's so funny or so clever, and he just nails you over the head over and over again, whether it's disgusting or disturbing. And it's just like, I get it, man. You don't need to keep showing it to get your point across. Like The Lobster, like that movie, there's so many sequences where it just goes further than it needs to go and keeps going. And you're just like, God damn it.
See, I like that it goes too far and it kind of annoys you a little bit.
It's like a Monty Python thing or something. I don't know where that comes from, that sort of dark humor.
No, I think it's a deliberate choice he's making, probably. It's not like, I don't think he's doing it because people don't get it. I think it's like, I want to take this further. Yeah, maybe because he thinks it's funny. That very well could be it. But it's like, we're just going to do this for a while. And if people don't like it, they don't like it. And I haven't gotten to like I don't know the actor's name. He's in Girls. But the shitty husband of the mother.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The ultimate sociopath.
Yeah, the sort of wealthy.
The general psycho, or whatever.
Psycho, yeah.
Yeah, they just call him the general. Yeah, he's an actual psychopath.
So we're supposed to believe that he was Bella, which her name wasn't Bella, right, before she killed herself.
Yeah,
I think he was, or she was, yeah.
And Victoria, she was going to be married to him, or was married to him?
She was married and pregnant with his baby. Yeah. And like hated him, and that's like why she killed herself. Like, I don't want to exist, this guy sucks. And
speaking of things looking cool, like when she jumped off the bridge and her body kind of sinking into the mist or whatever, and then it kind of zooms out with the bridge and the ocean there, like, man, this looks fucking amazing. I don't know what world I'm in, I don't know what universe this is, but looks cool as shit, you know. It's not not Quantumania where you're just like, this is trash green screen garbage, you know.
Oh no, this was deliberately shot, and you didn't care that it didn't give us a year, right? We didn't get a year, Eric. Okay. That bothered you in Speed Racer. We didn't know anything about where we were. It was set in an insular. You didn't like that about Speed Racer. But here, we don't get a year. We don't know where it's set. It just creates its own world.
It's you know, Victorian London. I don't think this is supposed to be in the future. Is that what you're trying to say?
Well, no. It's like this sort of alternate reality.
I don't think it's supposed to be in the alternate reality.
I mean, you look at those weird spaceships that are going about.
Gondolas. There was no spaceships.
They were up in the sky. This isn't something that they had in Victoria.
Gondolas.
No, but they literally had like cable cars up in the sky.
Yeah, a gondola.
But they didn't have the. You had. They
sure,
had those
sure
in the,
they did.
The 19th century. They had electric. They had electricity. They have electricity in the Victorian era, the 19th century.
Well, I don't. They had car. They had automobiles. This isn't like. We're not talking like the 1600s.
They didn't have automobiles in the 1870s.
I don't think it's that. I don't think it's supposed to be that long ago. I think it's like the turn of the century, like 1910s or whatever.
Okay. I don't know. It looked like an alternate reality to me. It did not look like the actual 1910s or 20s or whenever it was supposed to be. It looked.
Didn't they have like they had like carriages with like heaters on them or something like that? I don't know. I didn't get I didn't get the sense that this was like some futuristic alternate universe.
It's not futuristic.
It was a Wes Anderson-esque like depiction of that time period where, you know, it's obviously not reality, but.
Well, the Victorian era is not the 1910s, I don't think. But anyway, I felt like it was an alternate past, is what I'm saying. It didn't seem like the future. It seemed like we're going to take this historical period and we're going to sci-fi it up and make it kind of goofy looking. And
right. I mean, you can't reanimate a human being. Like, that's not technology that exists today, right? So,
or brain transplant.
Yeah. So that's obviously science fiction, but
I thought there was more to it than that, but that's fine. Timeline wise, I don't know. I love the way the movie looked. It was very interesting to look at consistently throughout it. And yeah, got a lot of fun colors, and we go black and white and make interesting lighting choices. And it was just I mean, I don't know. I don't have any movie that it's like all that much. It felt like its own unique thing, which doesn't happen all that often. So it's like, hey, this feels insular, which always scores points with me. Are you looking up timelines, Eric? What are you
typing? Yeah, I'm looking up when it is supposed to take place. So yeah, it's based off a novel. It appears to be set in the 19th century.
Okay. See, if it's set in the 19th century, the technology does not match, which is like, because I got the Victorian vibes. I got the Frankenstein vibes. I mean, I felt like it was Frankenstein, really, like Mary Shelley Frankenstein vibes, but the technology is too advanced.
Doesn't have a clear set timeline.
And somebody talks about, the general talks about military stuff that sounds like it could be World War I, but it could also be whatever, like the Boer War or something. I don't know. But yeah, it felt like a fake version of history.
I got the sense like late 1800s, but
that's fine. Point is, it's just set in its own place. I don't think it tries to particularly recreate reality in any kind of meaningful way. It's creating its own reality, which works for the film, I think, really, really well.
Yeah, I mean, it's science fiction. There's, you know, a lot of that stuff doesn't exist even today. So it doesn't really matter when it takes place.
But it mattered in Speed Racer, which is my ultimate point.
Well, I mean, is Speed Racer science fiction, or is it just supposed to be like a future reality? Whatever. We don't need to debate this. It doesn't matter. Stupid discussion. Speed Racer is a terrible movie.
But I would call it science fiction. I mean, call me crazy. But fair enough. I was just trying to see if I could poke a little hole in the double standard in your brain and explore that, Eric. But fair enough. You like this movie, you don't like Speed Racer. But I don't know. I mean, Bella's a fun character to root for. It's interesting watching people react to her. I like the old lady on the cruise ship.
Is she, though? Isn't she kind of evil? I guess she doesn't intend to do the things that she does.
What does she do that's evil?
Does she do anything kind to anybody? Is she kind or generous?
She tries to give money, all of the gambling money, to the poor.
She gives us a random...
She's naive. That's not evil. The intention is kind. I have money. I want to give it to these people who are suffering and genuinely need it. And these men who clearly just pocketed the money, but said that they would take it.
She lives a pretty selfish existence.
She acknowledges that.
All she wants to do is learn things and take care of herself and, you know, please herself.
She learns about suffering and decides she wants to do something about it. And then with no money, she tries to figure out, well, all right, I'm going to imagine I'm poor. How would I do something? And then I'm going to go out and make money the shortest route possible by being a prostitute. And then she's going to be a doctor and ostensibly help people, but I guess she'll make money, but that's selfish. But she at least engages with her privilege a little bit. Max doesn't. Willem Dafoe doesn't. Certainly Mark Ruffalo doesn't. She goes to like a socialist meeting at one point when Mark Ruffalo confronts her. So I don't know. Maybe she's selfish a little bit, but I don't know if that's evil. I don't know. I don't see anybody else doing anything for anybody in the movie. She tries at one point to do one thing. But anyway, I like seeing a character who absolutely has no pretensions about what anything should be, no concept, and then deconstructs it or tries to construct it from the ground up. And has to come to the realization about how things work. I don't know. I think that's was compelling to me. And she turns the table on Mark Ruffalo. I mean, that's totally great.
Okay. I mean, I don't have a whole lot else to say. Like I said, it was probably my Anatomy of the Fall was probably my least favorite Oscar movie of the bunch. but this is probably my second least favorite. If I had to rank them.
Okay. Can you name all the nominees off the top of your head, Eric?
Oppenheimer. There was Killers of the Flower Moon, Past Lives, Anatomy to Fall, Poor Things, Zone of Interest, American Fiction, Barbie? Barbie was nominated, wasn't it?
I think so.
For Best Picture. How many did I name there? I think I got most of them.
I think I said eight. That's what I got.
Oh.
But I was just curious. I was trying to see if I could do a rough ranking. I mean, I liked Poor Things more than you and Killers of the Flower Moon a lot less than you. Poor Things might be number two behind Oppenheimer.
I think so. Past Lives. I thought that was very good.
What's Past Lives about?
It's about a woman that has like a relationship with a man in Korea, and she comes to America, and it's just like a childhood love story where they sort of never stopped loving each other, and then they connect, and she's married, and she lives in America, and he lives in Korea.
Is it a foreign language movie?
Yeah, it's a Korean movie.
Okay, yeah.
Well, there's a lot of English in it. I mean, she comes to America and speaks English in America.
But American Fiction's really good. You'd like it, by the way. It might be up there, too. I'd have to really think about it. It's really, really a funny, smart, well-written movie. On a side note.
Okay.
Would recommend.
Cool.
Way less weird than Poor Things, so you won't have to deal with any baby talk from the adult woman.
I mean, I'm into the The Holdover. Really like The Holdovers.
Okay.
That was probably top three for me. And then Maestro were the other two.
There we go. I had not seen Maestro.
Maestro was all right. I enjoyed it enough. Bradley Cooper went crazy in that movie. But, it's just like a traditional movie about somebody's life.
Yeah, it looked like a standard biopic.
Yeah.
He's a genius. So, he's smart, but he's complicated. He's got some rough edges.
I mean, from what I heard, he nailed Leonard Bernstein in his mannerisms. Yeah.
There's like a 10 or 15 minute scene where he's just like conducting. Yeah. And it's him doing it. And the camera just sort of spins around while the orchestra is playing. And I guess you can watch a video of Leonard Bernstein actually doing that performance. And it, like, you know, you could split cut him and it'd be hard to pick out who's who, just the way that he does it. So. Yeah, totally committed. There's like a weird 50s, like old Hollywood part to the movie that I didn't connect with, because I think Spielberg was at some point supposed to direct that, and it's got a lot of the, like, because he wrote scores for movies, and I think he wrote the West Side Story score, right? Wasn't that one of Bernstein? Yeah, so there's like a big, you know, old Hollywood part to it that I didn't vibe with, but...
Okay.
But Oppenheimer, the bomb, best movie of the year, won Best Picture, blew them all away.
We agree, our number ones are the same.
Did you like Oppenheimer, Kevin? Unless you, I mean, maybe you'll pick at some point. I don't want to spoil it.
Oh no, haven't seen it.
Whoa. Okay. Wow.
Haven't seen it. I wasn't a fan of Dunkirk.
What?
So. It's on my to watch list, but it's not burn. And
I think it's better than Dunkirk. I don't know if that will help you, Kevin, but
yeah, that does. Yeah, no, I it's on a lot of people's top 10 movie lists. I'm sure it's a great movie, but I was out of Barbie and Oppenheimer. I was more of a Barbie guy, I guess.
Here's this. We're going to ease into ratings, it sounds like, but like, can we compare briefly Poor Things and Barbie?
Yeah, they're very similar, about a naive person getting out there.
Yeah, it's
discovering her womanhood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how shitty men can be.
Yeah, which one's more feminist? I think Barbie took shit too. People were saying that movie's not feminist either.
Really?
I think people thought it focused too much on Ken. That was one thing I saw a fair amount of. Too much on Ken. Also, Greta Gerwig should clearly win Best Director, but she focused too much on Ken. I don't know how you reconcile those two necessarily, but people said it was just too much about men and the side character. But that was kind of the point, because we're contrasting the matriarchy of Barbie Land with the patriarchy of our reality. When you kind of need that, you're trying to, so it's the structure that's the problem. It's not innately human, it's the structure.
Well, I also heard it wasn't political, like, right? It was discussing the sort of systems of patriarchy, but it wasn't actually pointing the finger at the political problems that exist in our country, you know?
Sure.
It was sort of trying to stay out of the political discussion, which can you really do that when you're discussing women's rights? I don't know. That was an argument I heard about it.
Well, they can try. I mean, I think right-wing people got mad at Barbie anyway, so I don't think it mattered. I think they were still pissed at it for being too anti-men.
Ben Shapiro was famously angry at it, which...
Didn't he burn Barbies or something like that?
I don't know.
Dummy. Ben, that's your favorite guy. You're a big Ben Shapiro guy.
Yeah, both a couple of 1984 kids. He fascinates me. He talks fast and he sounds confident, so I think people think he's smarter than he actually is. When he talks to somebody who's not like a college freshman, you know, who's a little more of a deep thinker and has had more experience, he doesn't do so well. You know, like one-on-one debate. No, I don't know. He's one of those. I wonder how much does he believe when he's talking about it, and how much is I can just do this to make money. It's one of the ones that I'm not sure. Like, is he smart enough to know like what I'm saying here is really stupid, but I'm gonna make $5 million, so I'm gonna keep.
Did he like Poor Things? Have we heard his review of Poor Things?
I'm sure he didn't like Poor Things, but I don't know. I haven't heard it. Poor Things didn't do the numbers Barbie did, but to me, Poor Things did. Well, Barbie did in a way that was more interesting to me, although they're both really visually, and I like Barbie a lot. But I suppose the weirdness, the setting, and the sort of ground level, this is kind of how sexism plays out in a basic way for women trying to live their life. We're going to just like condense a woman's lived experience via this baby conceit in a 2.5 hour movie or whatever it is. I don't know, I liked it better, but yeah, they are comparable.
Yeah, I like Barbie better. I thought it was more entertaining.
Is it just because you like Margot Robbie more than Emma Stone? Is that what it boils down to?
Wow. Not everything's just sexual, Ben.
Oh, okay. That's a good point. You're right, it isn't.
So yeah, way to contribute to the patriarchy over there, buddy.
I didn't say anything exactly. I just said like. Like can mean a lot of things, but fair enough.
I definitely like Margot Robbie more than Emma Stone if we're actually doing this, but you know, you didn't ask me.
I don't get the appeal of Emma Stone in general, like La La Land. I don't know why she won an Oscar for that.
Well, that's a different story. She shouldn't for that movie. But this one I get, although I think she genuinely felt bad because everybody probably wanted Lily Gladstone to win.
Yeah, well, Lily Gladstone was great in Killers of the Flower Moon, right? Absolutely should have won instead of Emma Stone. Although Lily Gladstone wasn't really the star.
Well, that's
she wasn't the lead actor, you know?
If she had gone the supporting actress route, she might have won. Yeah. I've heard some speculation.
I mean, she's the lead actress in that movie, but is she really a lead actor in that movie?
No, she's sidelined getting fake insulin for most of it. So I don't know. No, she's great. I mean, she's the only reason that movie kind of works. I mean, because of her performance. Her performance is great. I have issues with Killers of Flower Moon, but her performance isn't it. But I don't know. Do you like Barbie better than Poor Things? Have you seen Barbie? Yeah.
Eric, you talking to me?
Yes. Your turn.
I probably enjoyed it more. Yeah, sure, it's didn't definitely have a more hour. Of a. Yeah.
Baby
not
stuff.
Not as much baby stabbing, and I mean, there's just like bodies getting cut open and like pus and like goo, and I'm
a
just not
tumor
a
tumor at one point.
Yeah, I'm just not a fan of that stuff. Like that turns me off big time. I'm just not into that kind of shit, just at all. Like surgeries and like, you know, I never could have been a doctor or any sort of medical professional. Just couldn't do it. So, okay. Yeah, Barbie does not have that. It has, you know, Margot Robbie.
But the music didn't upset you too much? The musical number that didn't just turn you off to Barbie so much? The people just broke out of
I didn't love the musical numbers in Barbie. Okay. Definitely a detraction for me.
Okay.
I guess that made sense in that world because that's just what they did. They just sang and danced and, you know, whatever. Speaking of singing and dancing in Barbie, I mean – Slash showing up at the Oscars. Unbelievable moment. Great moment
for
me.
That was a death knell.
Victory lap for me.
Done with Guns N' Roses forever now.
It's funny because that's like they're sort of making fun of it at the same point too, but it's also awesome. So I think that's pretty smart.
Sure.
Yeah.
Slash should have been in Barbie. Why was he not in the movie? What the hell were they thinking? Greta Gerwig, come on.
Was he gonna play like another Ken doll, or he's just
could show a Slash Ken
walking around the beach? Like, hey, man.
What a cross promotion! Think of all the slashes they'd sell.
Yeah, Slash Ken. Come on.
Maybe they just couldn't afford him. You know, I don't know. I don't know what it takes to get Slash in the movie, financially speaking.
But got some shredding and Slash in my Oscars, and Oppenheimer wins. It was really a perfect night for me.
Good, I'm glad. I'm glad it ended well for you, Eric. So Poor Things, give it a number, Eric.
Like I said, it started at a 2, like, or a 1 with the first few scenes. It kind of crept up. I think it ended at about like a 3.5 at the end of the movie.
Okay.
Yeah, and yeah, I liked it slightly more than Eric. I give it a 4. It was too long. Too long.
Sorry, I'm laughing because I gave it 4 stars also.
You guys are on a streak.
I thought you would have gone higher with that, but yeah.
I don't have the pacing issues are a problem, really. I guess I agree that there's times where it takes too long. And I liked Mark Ruffalo, but at one point I was also like, oh, we're bringing Mark Ruffalo back. I thought we were done with his character. Okay, I don't know that I needed more of him.
When he comes back, I was like, I think he adds a lot, but I thought we were done.
We were done with his arc. I don't think we needed.
You made the point. Yeah, you made the point.
You could have not had that and just we see him in the insane asylum and it would have been just fine. Like I didn't need to see him again.
I agree.
And I could do 4.5. I mean, I did like it visually a lot. It's just not quite a 5-star. I didn't take a lot away from it really. It didn't like stick with me in a way like Lobster stuck with me. That was a movie that lingered in my brain a lot after I watched it. This one, and a favorite also, but this one was like, ultimately, yeah, men are shitty. Okay, that's fine. We put a goat brain in the general's body. I don't know. I was hoping they'd do something more interesting than that. I mean, the character deserved his fate. I'm not upset about it morally, but it's like,
Yeah, they could have put Defoe's brain in.
I thought that was where it was going to go. Like, yeah, oh, hey, you're going to get to relive life as a normal person. You're going to get to know what it's like to get an erection because you never had one because your dad castrated you when you were 8 or whatever it was. Like,
Then come on to Bella? That would have been a weird twist.
Well, that would have been really weird. Weird psychosexual craziness. So I wasn't sure of the ambiguity.
But you're a big fan of that psychosexual craziness.
Not usually, no.
Okay.
It can work.
Only sometimes.
If it's done right, you know, it's got to be the right kind of psychosexual craziness, you know. You do it wrong, then it's just not fun. I thought maybe...
That's what was missing from Barbie, really, was psychosexual craziness.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
Craziness. No, you're fine. No, you're fine. I don't have anything else to add. I said it just like if it had lingered more or thought it really had stuck the landing, it might have been a 4.5 star movie. But it was like, yeah, it was just some of the pacing issues, especially. And the part I like the least is the beginning when she's in baby mode. That isn't my favorite part. The weirdness isn't as off-putting to me, but it's like, okay, yeah. That's not the part I remember or care about. It's a part you do kind of have to get through. So that's why I go with 4 stars, but flirt with 4.5. But I was shocked. I thought this was going to be two guys like, this is, she acts like a child. This is stupid. This movie is shit.
If I had turned it off like Kevin had said 10 minutes in, I would have said this is the worst movie I've ever seen.
A new low. It would have supplanted Speed Racer.
Maybe not. Speed Racer wasn't my low. I've given a 0.5 star. THX was a 0.5 star.
So THX
yes, because you have to give it something. Otherwise, it would be 0.
You would give it 0. Who cares? There's no rules. Give it -8 if you want to be really clever or something. Who cares? I'm curious. Okay, so THX is the bottom for a movie we've
covered. I think Cabaret was also a half star.
Okay.
Those are the two lows.
That's still the nadir, or those two. Yeah. Okay. So we gotta
pick a movie that Kevin. We gotta find a Kevin half star movie. Maybe Oppenheimer. Maybe he hated it so much. We'll see.
If we did Oppenheimer and Kevin absolutely hated it that much, that would be my favorite podcast. Cause I would try to just sit back and just let you two hash it out. I would just your incredulity that he hated the movie and thinks it sucks.
I will say Oppenheimer is not my favorite Nolan movie.
Yeah, it's probably not my favorite either, although it's an incredible movie.
Yeah.
I don't know if I rank it number one or not, but it's...
What's your ranking, Eric?
Three or four, maybe.
Ooh.
Inception's still number one. Probably Dark Knight 2.
Okay.
Oppenheimer's probably in there. It's in the mix there. Three.
Yeah.
Probably then Prestige 4.
See, Prestige is a movie I couldn't stand.
Really? Yeah. Oh, I love that movie. So great. Memento, probably 5. Dunkirk, maybe Dunkirk 5. I'm too. Dunkirk should be higher. Sorry. this is not the Nolan podcast, but
you can go reconfigure your Nolan ranking after this on your own.
Yeah, time. I got a laminated sheet over here. I got to update it.
You're gonna have to retype it out.
Yep.
Okay.
All right.
Well, Kevin, you're up to pick the next movie.
Where do we go from here? Maybe it'll be a half star one. I doubt it. I've seen it, and it is spectacular. It's 2023 movie.
Okay.
Oh.
Another okay. 2023. Yeah, we're living in the now. Let's see. It's based in Canada. Based in Canada, eh?
Okay.
It's directed by Matt Johnson.
Matt Johnson?
I don't know who the hell that is.
Oh, I think I know what this is.
It's got for 2023 in Rotten Tomatoes, it's the third highest rated movie.
Is it Blackberry?
It is Blackberry.
Okay.
I have never heard of this. I have no idea what this is.
It's about
the story of Blackberry.
Yeah.
Oh, the actual, not the fruit, but like the
electronic
device.
Yeah. Glenn Howerton stars in it.
He's incredible. So, I have seen, I don't know if you knew this, but they released it on AMC in like as a three-part series.
Oh, like a TV show? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's like three episodes, like a mini series. I haven't actually watched the movie, but I have seen that.
Oh, okay. There you go.
Okay.
Is this streaming? Is the movie itself streaming anywhere?
Yeah, it's streaming on Hulu.
It is on Hulu. Okay. Excellent. Yeah,
it's a movie that I enjoyed quite a bit. And
if you like sort of Social Network-esque like tech startup, sure. Building legacy kind of thing. If that's your jam, which I like a lot, like Silicon Valley kind of
essence. Yeah. Except based in Canada.
Right.
Which surprised me.
And I learned later on the Matt Johnson guy, it triggered, right? That's his name, Matt Johnson?
Yeah.
He's in the movie, right? He's the guy with the headband?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I didn't know that until after, like, way after the fact. I was like, oh, shit, that's actually the director.
I think you'll like it, Ben.
Oh, I'm sure I'll give it more than a half star. I don't know what kind of movie I would give a half star to, but it would...
It's got a 98% on Rotten Tomatoes.
It should have
seen some Oscar nominations.
Yeah, Howerton probably could have snuck in there. He's pretty good in the movie.
Yeah.
I don't know who he would replace though.
Wait, you said Glenn Howerton?
Yeah, from It's Always Sunny.
Okay.
Yeah. Wow. He's really good. He's really good in it.
Is he Mr. Blackberry? Is he Blackberry dude?
He's one of the lead guys that push the device.
Interesting. Okay.
We'll talk about this next week, but like this, the whole story that it's not that long ago, it seems like all this is like ancient history, but it's really not, how quickly the cell phone industry changed.
Yeah, that's part of the story is how quickly it changed.
Okay, well, right. I'm excited to check it out. I don't think I knew that this movie existed, but now, yes, I've got a template in my brain. So, all right, looking forward to checking it out.
God watch Blackberry.
Blackberry God... probably my, well, least favorite fruit.
God let us leave this house. Okay, thanks, guys. Have a good night, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Take it easy.
Don't kill frogs.